I want to take this time to invite you and your family to join me for the next 30 minutes as we read, we study, and we meditate upon the Word of God together. My opening scripture is taken from the 16th chapter of St. Matthew and the 21st through the 23rd verse. And in these scriptures, Jesus Christ is talking to his disciples about his impending suffering and death. From then on, Jesus began telling his disciples about what would happen to him. He said, "I must go to Jerusalem. There the nation's leaders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law of Moses will make me suffer terribly. I will be killed, but 3 days later, I will rise to life." Peter took Jesus aside and told him to stop talking like that. He said, "God would never let this happen to you, Lord." Jesus turned to Peter and said, "Satan, get away from me. You're in my way because you think like everyone else and not like God." And as we read further in the 26th chapter of St. Matthew and the 31st through the 35th verse, it became quite evident that Jesus knew exactly what he was talking about. Jesus said to his disciples, "During this very night, all of you will reject me. As the scriptures say, I will strike down the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised to life, I will go to Galilee ahead of you." Peter spoke up, "Even if all the others reject you, I never will." Jesus replied, "I promise you that before a rooster crows tonight, you will say 3 times that you don't know me." But Peter said, "Even if I have to die with you, I will never say I don't know you." And all the others said the same thing. And these very same disciples spoke of their undying and unwavering alliance and loyalty to Jesus Christ, but under the right circumstances, and when a push came to a shove, and the disciples were facing the possibility of arrest and execution themselves, that was when they totally abandoned Christ and fled when Jesus needed them the most. And such action on their part really drives home the fact that talk is cheap, but it's your actions which is the thing that gives credibility to your words. And therefore, it's very important that you say what you mean and mean what you say. And as I state in the title of my sermon, never say never if you don't truly mean it. Now, I'm sure that for many people, it may seem very ironic and strange that we had 12 men who were privileged with the opportunity of sitting before the Master himself, Jesus Christ, and they heard the scriptures being interpreted in a way that no other human being could convey unto them. And the confirmation of what he said was true was confirmed by the many miracles, signs, and wonders that were displayed as a testimony to his deity of being the Son of God. And in the four Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, there's an innumerable amount of examples of the miracle-working power that Jesus displayed, proving once and for all that he truly had the power and the anointing of God upon his life. And it was that anointing to heal the sick, bring sight to the blind, and restore healing to the deaf. But for myself, the most convincing and powerful display of God's Holy Ghost power in the life of Jesus Christ was when Jesus ministered to a dead man. A man who had been dead for 4 days, and yet after Jesus spoke to the dead man, whose name was Lazarus, and commanded him to arise from the tomb, then instantaneously the man obeyed the command of Jesus Christ. And the man returned to the land of the living. And this incident is described to us in the 11th chapter of St. John and the 1st through the 45th verse. A man by the name of Lazarus was sick in the village of Bethany. He had two sisters, Mary and Martha. The sisters sent a message to the Lord and told him that his good friend Lazarus was sick. When Jesus got to Bethany, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Jesus then said, "I am the one who raises the dead to life. Everyone who has faith in me will live, even if they die. And everyone who lives because of faith in me will never really die." After the stone had been rolled aside, Jesus looked up toward heaven and prayed, "Father, I thank you for answering my prayer. I know that you always answer my prayers, but I said this so that the people here could believe that you sent me." When Jesus had finished praying, he shouted, "Lazarus, come out." The man who had been dead came out. His hands and feet were wrapped with strips of burial cloth, and a cloth covered his face. Jesus then told the people, "Untie him and let him go." Many of the people who had come to visit Mary saw the things that Jesus did, and they put their faith in him. You know, I'm confident that the onlookers, as well as the disciples themselves, were mesmerized and totally confounded by this amazing resurrection from the grave of Lazarus. And you would think that such an experience would leave an indelible impression upon them, that any thought of them betraying and forsaking the Lord Jesus Christ would be simply ludicrous and beyond the realm of possibilities. But the scriptures themselves vividly reveal to us that not only was there a possibility of a betrayal by the disciples, but it actually came to pass. And the most unlikely leader of the vanguard of defectors among the disciples of Jesus Christ was Saint Peter, the most prominent of the 12 apostles, traditionally the first bishop of Rome. Now his name was Simon, but Jesus called him Cephas, which is Aramaic for rock. And when we study the four Gospels, you will find that Peter was the leader and spokesman of the 12 disciples. And Jesus most often addressed him when he was speaking to the disciples. But the events in Peter's life seemed a bit paradoxical in nature. Here was a man who Jesus felt had great potential, and he had many of the qualities and attributes which would lead to him being a great leader and a great disciple that could spread the good news about God's plan of salvation for mankind, which was about Jesus Christ himself. Here was a man and a disciple who was the leader of the pack and the one you would most likely and logically vote to be the one who would most likely succeed. But it was this Simon Peter, who took a fall and momentarily fell from grace in the eyes of God. But God did not give up on Peter. But Peter realized the seriousness of his denial of being associated with and being a disciple of Jesus Christ. And Peter repented of his sins, and he asked God for his forgiveness. And God forgave him. and gave Peter another chance. And Jesus Christ himself also forgave Peter, for after the resurrection, Jesus appeared and charged Peter to feed my sheep. And this event is described to us in the 21st chapter of St. John and the 1st through the 19th verse. Jesus later appeared to his disciples along the shore of Lake Tiberias. Jesus said, "Come and eat." But none of the disciples dare ask who he was. They knew that he was the Lord. Jesus took the bread in his hands and gave some of it to his disciples. He did the same with the fish. This was the third time that Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from death. When Jesus and his disciples had finished eating, he asked, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than the others do?" Simon Peter answered, "Yes, Lord, you know I do." "Then feed my lambs," Jesus said. Jesus asked a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter answered, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." "Then take care of my sheep," Jesus told him. Jesus asked a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus had asked him three times if he loved him. So he told Jesus, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus replied, "Feed my sheep." Then he said to Peter, "Follow me." And in the subsequent months and years to follow, Peter did indeed follow Jesus with great zeal, enthusiasm, and commitment. And the Acts of the Apostles describes Peter's role as leader in the early apostolic period. Now, Peter established many churches in many localities in such places such as Antioch and in the city of Rome. And it was in Rome that he died as head of the local church, and he became a martyr there under the rule of the Roman Emperor Nero. And it was through the grace of God that Peter was given a second chance to go from being a coward to being looked upon as a stalwart and staunch supporter of Jesus Christ. Peter was willing to give up his life in spreading the good news about Jesus Christ, which in turn caused him to inherit eternal life and eternal salvation with the Lord. And I'm sure that this was made possible because Peter recalled an incident in which Jesus told him and the other disciples, as well as the other people who were with them, about the importance of committing yourself totally to the Lord. For in St. Mark, this incident is described to us. For we are told in the 8th chapter of St. Mark, in the 34th through the 37th verse, Jesus then told the crowd and the disciples to come closer, and he said, "If any of you want to be my follower, you must forget about yourself. You must take up your cross and follow me. If you want to save your life, you will destroy it. But if you give up your life for me and for the good news, you will save it. What will you gain if you own the whole world but destroy yourself? What could you give to get back your soul?" And it's the soul and spirit aspect of a person. This is the true essence of who that person is, and it's the most valuable possession that they possess. For you see, it's not the materialistic things you gain during your lifetime which will retain an eternal value. No, it's your soul. For it's your soul that is the only thing that has lasting value depending upon the choices you make during your lifetime. And from the beginning of human history, there's been a constant battle between the forces of evil and the forces of good and capturing the souls of men, women, and children. And the forces of evil are in league with an angelic being known as Satan. And the forces of good are directed by Jehovah God, the creator of the universe, and from the very beginning, Satan has tried to usurp the sovereign authority of God as supreme commander of this universe. And so this constant spiritual battle between God and Satan has been raging throughout the centuries. Remember, money is no barrier to Satan. He's willing to give you money, fame, and the material things of this world in order to capture your soul. And for many people, the significance of one's soul is unimportant, especially if they read the study that was done by a Swedish scientist who conducted controlled experiments using extremely sensitive weights. And he made note of a person's weight, of persons who were terminally ill and about to die. And at the moment of their death, he noted the decrease in the weight of the body, and he found that at the moment of that person's death, shortly thereafter, the weight itself decreased 21 grams, which is less than 1 ounce. Yet this seemingly insignificant part of one's being is the most important part of one's existence. But this part of you is a part of your existence that Satan wants to possess. And he has initiated an end-time battle plan to make it a reality. And that plan includes a consortium of political, business, and religious leaders who will exhort and champion this plan that to the world may seem to be messianic in nature. A plan that will seem to bring lasting peace to the most troubled spot in the world, which is the Middle East. And this plan, if this plan is not carefully scrutinized, it will cause millions of people to believe a lie, to believe that what is wrong is right and what is right is wrong. And the two leading characters in Satan's plan of deception will be a very powerful and charismatic political leader who will be known as the Antichrist. And the Antichrist will solicit and enlist the aid of the most powerful religious leader in the world and have him give his public support to the plan that he espouses to. And as a result, it will cause millions of people throughout the world to think that this plan is a plan that is divine in nature. And to get some idea of the deceptiveness and effectiveness of this plan, Satan's mode of operation, which the Antichrist and the false prophet will implement, is revealed to us in the 13th chapter of Revelation and the 14th through the 18th verse. The second beast fooled people on earth by working miracles for the first one. Then it talked them into making an idol in the form of the beast that did not die after being wounded by a sword. It was allowed to put breath into the idol so that it could speak. Everyone who refused to worship the idol of the beast was put to death. All people were forced to put a mark on their right hand or their forehead. Whether they were powerful or weak, rich or poor, free people or even slaves, they all had to have this mark or else they could not buy or sell anything. This mark stood for the name of the beast and for the number of his name. You need wisdom to understand the number of the beast, but if you are smart enough, you can figure this out. Its number is 666, and it stands for a person. And this person's number is 666. And very very shortly. This man of sin is about to make his grand appearance on the world scene. And what's so alarming about it all is the fact that the Antichrist's plan of destruction has already been implemented, and it already has touched the lives of many unsuspecting victims. And the tentacles of this satanic evil plan of Satan has touched victims who may be closer than you think. In fact, let me direct you toward this article, which was published on St. Valentine's Day on a Tuesday, February the 14th of this year, in the Dayton Daily News. And the headlines were prominently displayed for all to see, and it said, ID chips implanted in arms. And the article reported that tiny chips were being embodied into two workers who volunteered to help test the tagging technology at a surveillance equipment company in Cincinnati, Ohio. Now, the radio frequency identification chips that were placed in the arms of the two volunteer workers at City Watcher is believed to be the first such use of the technology in living human beings in the United States. Now, this chip is the size of a grain of rice, and it's implanted just under the skin in one's forearm. Now, a company spokesman said it lets company employees into restrictive areas, the same way as a key card does. Now, the company that makes this chip is named VeraChip Corporation, a company that is based in Florida. Now, the company touts the fact that the chip has many beneficial uses, such as tracking down hospital patients and nursing home residents who tend to wander away from the facilities. They say that it's a passive chip and emits no signal whatsoever. It's the same thing as a key card. It will not infringe on anyone's rights. But remember, this is what they say for public consumption. But the true purpose for these chips is something less than benevolent. Even though the company who makes these chips says it's all volunteer on the part of the workers, my advice to you is don't believe it. Eventually, it will become mandatory for all companies and employees of those companies, and this will apply to all institutions. The retail industry, as well as banking and commercial institutions as well. You won't be able to cash your check without one of these chips embedded in your body. Yes, the devil is alive and well in the year 2006. Yes, he has implemented plans to capture and to win your soul. Any spiritual complacency on your part must end immediately, for you and your family must get serious with God. We are living in a time frame right now when you cannot procrastinate any longer. You have to make a decision. You will either do it God's way or Satan's way. And you might say that we are experiencing a form of deja vu. You are like the people of the prophet Elijah's time, and the prophet preached to them, and you may find yourself in that same position that they were in. You must decide whether you will do it God's way or allow yourself to be seduced into doing it Satan's way. After hearing the truth from the prophet of God, they had to make some hard decisions as to whom they would serve. And this is revealed to us in 1 Kings, the 18th chapter, in the 19th through the 21st verse. Call together everyone from Israel and have them meet me on Mount Carmel. Be sure to bring along the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah who eat at Jezebel's table. Ahab got everyone together. Then they went to meet Elijah on Mount Carmel. Elijah stood in front of them and said, "How much longer will you try to have things both ways? If the Lord is God, worship him. But if Baal is God, then worship him." We have now entered into the tribulation period. It's either put up or shut up and ship out time, as far as the Lord Jesus Christ is concerned. Jesus will not tolerate any indecision or a lukewarm commitment in serving him. For today is your day of salvation. If you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then do it right now. Or if you are not on fire in serving the Lord, then it's time for you to make that commitment now. Whatever the condition of your life, whatever the condition of your life is in right now, it's time for you to make a change. And you can do it by simply lifting your hands with me and repeating these words. My Heavenly Father, I realize the seriousness of the time and that Satan is about to implement his plan of destruction for the human race. And so, Father, I'm committing myself to you by accepting Jesus Christ into my life as my Lord and Savior. I'm repenting of my sins and asking for your forgiveness. And in Jesus' name I pray, amen. That's all that it took. You are now included in the family of God. And God loves you. And you have made God extremely happy by committing your life unto his Son, Jesus Christ, and by being adopted into his family. And our God is a wonderful, loving God who wants to help you in all areas of your life. Whatever your needs may be, simply trust him and believe in him. I want you to lift your hands with me right now. Heavenly Father, I have spoken the words unto the people. I'm asking now, Father, that you confirm the word with signs, wonders, and miracles throughout the Miami Valley. You are well aware of each person's need. I'm asking that you meet their need with a special miracle that's designed just for them. And we will give you the praise and the honor. And we thank you. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. The miracle is yours. Accept it by faith and then begin to praise and thank God for your miracle. Hallelujah. I want to take this time to thank you very much for watching, and I'd like to invite you to write to us. You can do so by writing to David Woods, Post Office Box 2102, Dayton, Ohio, 45401. On behalf of myself and my sons, David and Devin Woods, we'd like to remind you to read your Bible every day and then pray. And may God bless you and your family.